Netcasts you love.
From people you trust.
This is TWiT.
Bandwidth for frame rate is provided by CacheFly at CacheFly.com.
This episode of Frame Rate is brought to you by MailRoute, email filtering in the cloud for companies and resellers of any size. MailRoute offers live human support and one-click sign-up. For free Postini migration and 10% off the life of your account, visit MailRoute.net, click the sign-up button, and enter the promo code FRAMERATE.
Arcade, where we have fun, friends, and Fix It Felix Jr. featuring Wreck-It Ralph. It's all new, fully 8-bit state of the art, and the hottest arcade game in the world. Test your skills against this totally rad wrecker who loves living up to his Wreck-It name. Only you can save Niceland.
I can fix it
and be the hero. Fix It Felix Jr. featuring Wreck-It Ralph now at Lit Racks Arcade on Route 83, offering two free quarters on your birthday.
It's Frame Rate! Solo! Brian!
Oh, Tom Meritz! How are you, sir?
I'm well. Welcome to Frame Rate episode 97. I am Tom Meritz. You are Brian Brushwood. Did you know that?
You already passed the quiz. Congratulations! You get to co-host this episode.
Woo-hoo! Winner every time. That's a winner. hey, you know what? I never liked Fix It Felix back when it was new.
Yeah, you know, I've always felt like it never got its due. It always flew under the radar until finally, I don't know why there's this big Fix It Felix craze. We're all remembering.
You know what? It's because of that movie Fix It Felix that's coming out.
No, the movie's called Wreck-It Ralph. And by the way, full disclosure, I totally own it in the movie draft. Not saying I'm trying to pump up my numbers, but by all accounts, it sounds like Wreck-It Ralph is going to wreck it.
No, you know what? I think that's fine. I think that's fair. For the same reason, I want people to know Here Comes the Boom is still in theaters.
Man, okay, we'll talk about it at the draft, but boy, here comes the butthurt Tom.
Not as bad as being a psychopath. Let's start with the big story.
This just in, the big story.
Felix Baumgartner jumped out of a balloon at the edge of space and landed on his feet yesterday. Not much of a story, really.
Oh, please. Well, it depends. I know that I tuned in for a little bit of TWiT, and Leo was sort of, you know, poo-pooing the whole thing. But, man, this was positively electric for me. This was like nothing I'd ever encountered. Go ahead.
No, I didn't mean to cut off your enthusiasm, but I was also poo-pooing this last week when he was first scheduled to do it, and then the weather delayed it. And so Sunday morning, I was, like, seeing people on Twitter and, like, oh, okay, I'm going to watch. This is going to be cool. I'm in the front room. Eileen comes out. She's like, why don't you have it on? I'm like, I can't find it anywhere. CNN isn't covering it. None of the broadcast networks are covering it. She's like, oh, well, I'm watching it on YouTube Live. She's like, but I know that Discovery has it. So I turn it over to Discovery, and we're watching the balloon rising. And we're like, oh, yeah. She's like, the picture looks pretty good on Discovery. Break for commercials. And she's like, oh, forget that. Go to YouTube.
Oh, that's great.
So we switch over to my MacBook Pro, AirPlay it from YouTube to the big screen, because she was watching it on YouTube on the Google TV, which is in the other bedroom. And we're like, the picture isn't quite as good, but you know what? No commercials. We watched it on YouTube. It was, you know, slightly delayed because we were watching it on YouTube because of, you know, just buffering and caching. But man, it was fantastic. No commercial interruption. And watching it along with everyone on Twitter, just joking about it and getting excited until the point where he steps to the edge of that capsule. Just magic. Ended up being a totally magic moment.
Now, was this when you were watching it in your, because you set it up on your living room as a primary viewing experience. Did you sit there and give it your full attention for the 2 hours it ascended there? Or did you kind of have to do another stuff?
It was pretty much, I never got to putting the YouTube stream airplayed through the Apple TV until he was about 110,000 feet.
Okay.
And so at that point, I was reading Twitter, maybe, you know, doing a little other surfing. But I was basically like playing with my iPad and keeping an eye on it. And then the closer he got to under 20,000 feet, pretty much from that on, from the time he passed 120,000 feet, I was watching Twitter and watching it and just looking at what people on Twitter were saying and watching it with them.
Because if you looked at the actual Red Bull website, they actually, in addition to, and I thought this was cool. Number one, major kudos to what Red Bull for trying something unprecedented in marketing, to do something so risky and to do it full on live, sink or swim. With not only are they live streaming everything there, so if there was a disaster, we were all going to watch it happen live, but they had his family right there and there. It was obvious that they were like, we're confident that we're going to make this thing work and we're going to let the electricity be about the fact that this is completely happening at this moment, right up to the point where when you looked at the Red Bull, the Stratus website, they had all these metrics on the side, stuff that there was no real need that they needed to tell inform the viewing populace about. But they had oxygen levels as a little Java applet, I assume Java or HTML5, whatever. The current inside temperature, exterior temperature, all the little metrics. Like you felt in some small way like you were there at mission control, helping to keep an eye on everything yourself. And I think that by bestowing a little bit of ownership to all of the viewing public, I think that's part of why this was such an electric event. Because I don't know about you, when you watched him start falling and you're just marveling at how far he's coming down, and then after a while, his body started to spin. I don't know enough to know what's in control and out of control, but it looked relatively out of control. And for this brief second, I mean, I got the full-on adrenaline rush, and I thought, oh, geez, this guy's going to die and we're all going to watch him die. Yeah. And then that moment when he regains control and stops spinning and you could tell he's clearly in a controlled dive, it was amazing, man. It was like nothing I'd experienced.
And I got the impression that he was doing this backed by his sponsor. That this wasn't a stunt where the sponsor controlled everything and said, hey, we hired this guy to go up to the edge of space and jump out. No, this is a professional sky jumper. This is someone who does this very seriously. And Mission Control was staffed with, you know, the previous record holder, Kittinger, and professionals who know how to do this stuff. This wasn't like, oh, the sponsor thought it'd be fun if we pulled this off. It was the sponsor saying, I would like to help you have the money to do this, and I'll attach my name to it, and then you go do it. And that comes through. And like you say, Red Bull very carefully said, we're going to put our name on the site, but we're not going to try to like put CG wings on him as he's falling down or have him like, you know, tilt back a drink before he jumps out. No, we're going to let him do his thing. And we're just going to be like, hey, we helped him to do it. And we'll give you the oxygen levels. And we know that what people are interested in is his feat of daring. Right. And we'll get the side benefit of that. And I thought that was smart.
Well, and I also, I like the fact that they brought in Kittinger, which, by the way, have you seen Kittinger's original jump?
I hadn't until yesterday afternoon. I went and watched it. Yeah,
it's right here. Take a look.
That's not what I saw.
This is Kittinger.
That's a different kitten.
Am I confused about what Kittinger we're talking about?
Yeah, so audio listeners, he's showing actual kittens jumping out. And they do that all the time. So that's not really a stunt for them.
Yeah, my mistake. That's now, by the way, that's two to two in the chat.
Other than just like the fact that people watch this on YouTube, 8 million people watched this on YouTube.
Yeah, there's some talk about a little bit of controversy on that part because on the one hand, from what I understood, and this is not the first time I'm hearing everything third hand, but there was some article saying that YouTube servers crashed and they had to lease bandwidth or something from Akamai. So it's like they didn't actually break a record for the number of live streams.
Well, that may or may not be true. But what they are counting there is whether YouTube servers did something or not. Fact of the matter is, you, me, everyone else, were on a page called YouTube.com or an app provided by YouTube and got the video. If YouTube had to go out to Akamai to get a little extra juice for that, that's a whole separate issue. That's an enterprise discussion, and who gets the bragging rights there would be Akamai in that situation. But that's interesting to me on a whole different level. What is also interesting to me is that 8 million concurrent people went to this place and started streaming this event and watched it no matter where they were. And this is something that television has not really been able to pull off. There have been portable televisions, but I just pull out my phone. I can watch it. I have a tablet with a connection. I can watch it. I'm at home. I can stream it to my television. I can watch it however I want, wherever I want. And it was, without a doubt, the most viewed internet event that YouTube has ever been involved with. I assume it may be the most that anyone has ever been involved with. Olympics probably passed it up, but it's pretty close.
Yeah, I don't know, though. But even the Olympics, you had so many different streams that people were watching for different events at different times. This was a singular moment that collectively, you know, we'll say 10% of the world's population held their breath and took a look. I mean, it's incredible.
Yeah, just really well done, Felix Baumgartner. Way to show the dolphins who's boss on this planet.
Try that, you dolphins.
Yeah,
have a fish.
I'd like to see that. I think you're so smart. Let's talk about another big story.
Stop everything. It's another big story.
It kind of feels like a denouement to talk about encryption standards when we just talked about a guy who jumped from space.
Yeah, but luckily we might be able to argue about this because I'm curious what this really means. I guess take us through the story and then we'll talk about
it. The story is that the FCC has improved encryption standards for cable companies in the United States. Before, they were required to provide a certain number of channels unencrypted to the subscribers so that you could at least get a certain amount of service without paying for a box. What they've said now is after a pilot study with Cablevision, they're going to lift that restriction. And basically, cable companies are not required to provide an unencrypted broadcast. So ClearQuam, I always say it wrong, ClearCam is gone. It may or may not be gone by every provider, but most providers are going to opt to say, we're going to encrypt this. And that allows them to do some good things other than just charge you more. Obviously, it allows them to collect more money, right? Because they can make sure that they charge you for box rentals, et cetera. However, the FCC has said a certain amount of free boxes have to be given to existing customers so that the price doesn't go up. They can't rent the boxes right away. And the other benefits for the consumer is because it's now encrypted and delivered digitally, cable companies can turn services on and off without having to send a truck to your location to unhook and hook wires together and throw switches. They can just do it all from a central office. It means you get your services faster and they don't have to spend as much money.
Okay, so the reasons that they had this to begin with are, number one, they didn't want to force anyone to have to rent a box in order to receive the service, right? So on the one hand, you have a bit of consumer protection. And I guess the other part is so that boxes like the Boxee Box or any of these other analog middlemen were able to record without having to, you know, for example, the original TiVo Series 1 would be able to function on it. But if there's a provision built into it that says that boxes like the Boxee Box are able to get and use the signal and you don't have to do a cheat or a workaround or legally break the encryption, do we think there's going to be any problem with this to consumer, or is it just sort of like it's hard for us to let go of anything that was open and see it become encrypted?
Yeah, I think that's part of it. I mean, if you're Boxee, if you're Avdaronin over at Boxee, you don't want to see it go away because that's how your new Boxee Box. I mean, there was a leak that a new Boxee Box would have come with a DVR and an over-the-air tuner in it. And you want that over-the-air tuner to be able to work by just plugging in that cable if you've got basic cable. That way, Boxee extends your ability to watch TV into any room you can run cable into, right? That's a limited number of people. Boxee is now saying, okay, we're fine with this because there's an ability to get these basic cable channels over IP that our boxes can take advantage of. So we don't care that much anymore. And that reduces the number of people who care about this to an even smaller amount of folks who just liked to have the wire coming out of the wall, plug it into the TV, and watch whatever came on. They weren't picky about it. They just wanted that extra service and maybe an extra room or out in the garage or whatever. The number of people who are going to complain about this is likely to be very small.
Yeah, well, and again, it's one of those things. I think we're more upset by the principle of what's happening than by any practical. I'm going to say from a practical standpoint, we are going to notice this not at all. But my heart goes out to anyone who's all in a tizzy. In fact, if you're that person who has a good, clear argument for why I should be as upset as you are, write us at framerateshow@gmail.com, fr@twit.tv.
What I think this does is pushes people to over the air. Over the air is a lot better in a lot more locations than it was when the digital transition first took place. When the digital transition first took place, I could get one channel with an antenna off my balcony in Oakland. By the time the transition was over, I could get 15 channels. When I moved to San Rafael a couple of years ago, I can get like 3 channels by pointing this little desktop antenna out my window. Yesterday, I was watching Fox over the air, which I didn't used to be able to get. So the broadcasts have improved. The antennas have improved. What this does to me is say, like, hey, if you're that type of person who likes plugging that cable in the wall, cancel your cable. Go over the air. You're going to get a better picture quality with no compression. And maybe you'll need to do a little fiddling about to get the right reception with your antenna. You might need to put something up on a roof. But you're going to get something that's better than what you were getting before with running those wires all over the place anyway.
Yeah. As a matter of fact, actually, this directly ties into one of our feedback emails. So I'll hold off on saying anything more till we get to that.
Let's do yet another big story.
Tuck in your bootstraps. It's yet another big story.
I almost got rid of this story until I finished reading it all the way through. And then I realized that this is actually a really, really good story. So what I'm going to do is say, I'm not going to try to summarize this Fast Company article about Hulu's Jason Kilar. Go read it. It's written by Nicole Laporte. I don't believe that's any relation to Leo, but I could be wrong. It is a very long feature article about what Jason Kilar has done at Hulu, why he's done it, his history coming from Amazon, how he's been able to continue to grow and develop Hulu when both external and internal influences have been set against him, and how he still isn't safe yet. There's memorandum leaking recently calling for his departure and a replacement as CEO of Hulu. But what I got by reading through this, Brian, I don't know if you got a chance to read through all of it.
I actually did. I've read through the entire thing, and I remember thinking the same thing you were just saying, where it's like, I don't see how we're going to summarize this and give due justice to this article. This is a fantastic profile, not only on Hulu as a company, which is what I thought I was going to be reading about, but about Kilar as the CEO. I think it's fantastic.
And strengths is like, I thought you weren't going to summarize it. I didn't. I told you that it's about Jason Kilar and the challenges he faced. But there's much more in the article about specific examples about what kinds of challenges he faced. And my impression of it is that this guy is, when you talk about, like, who's your next Steve Jobs, this guy is that kind of personality. The fact that he's able to keep Hulu as good as it is in the face of what he has been challenged with is incredibly impressive. And the opening paragraphs talk about him obsessing over the redesign of Hulu and how much better they've made it. This guy cares about quality. He cares about the user experience above all, and he will not compromise. That's what I got out of this article.
Yeah, I think it's fantastic. Definitely everybody read it. I'm pretty sure, well, actually, I'm not going to say anything. That photo credit on there says Joe Pugliese, which I believe another lifetime ago, 12 years ago, I believe that is the guy who was our stage manager when I toured with Rascal Flatts and Brad Paisley and Brooks and Dunn.
Oh, funny.
That's so good. What a weird moment for him to pop up like that. Crazy.
The article is definitely worth reading. And frankly, if Hulu doesn't want him, somebody should snap him up. Either Google should snap him up for YouTube, or Amazon should bring him back into the fold for Amazon Prime, or maybe Netflix could just say, you know, Reed Hastings, take a really long vacation, Jason, run the company. Because this guy is going to crack the problem that we're talking about on this show every week. I have a feeling. Whether he's allowed to do it at Hulu or not.
Well, and that's just it. It certainly seems like everything we've seen from Hulu has been an effort to bring about the fantasy that you and I have wanted so much for so long.
Yeah, definitely. Let's move into the slipstream, shall we? I just screwed up Jason because we were supposed to go to the GAD.
It's okay.
And I heard him grunt. and that was what I realized.
That was me saying, but I didn't have my mic on.
Yeah.
So it came across as a grunt.
Okay,
sorry.
We'll go to slipstream. Dumbass.
Jerk.
Fine. So this episode of the slipstream is brought to you by MailRoute. MailRoute provides you maximum no spam. Brian, tell them all about
MailRoute. Oh my gosh, dude. Let me tell you, you know what I love, Tom? I love spam. I love offers and weekly updates.
Wait, what?
Brian. Oh, no. I'll tell you. You know, it's like nothing makes me feel lonelier than opening up my email and only receiving meaningful correspondence from friends and relatives. What I really want is just a little bit of noise, you know?
You want spam. You want a bunch of advertisements. You want a bunch of unsolicited. What you want, it sounds like to me, Brian, is for 97% of the mail that comes to my address to just be sent to you.
Oh, dude, absolutely. Because here's the thing. It makes it like a game to try to find important updates, right? Because then you have to sift through all this other stuff. Just something to keep your mind busy for 8-10 hours a day. The more spam, the better, I say. And whatever you do, don't take my spam away, Tom.
I have a bone to pick with you about that. Because I don't think you're being serious.
What? Why? Who doesn't love spam? Who doesn't love inappropriate ads in their email box?
I don't think anybody wants inappropriate ads.
Here's the thing, Tom, is the problem is you're not going to stop it. Spam's here forever, so I've just decided to love it. There is no solution to stopping spam. I've said it. Put my name. Go ahead and boilerplate that. Go ahead and make a stamp. Put it on every $1 bill out there. Let the world hear that Brian Brushwood says there's no way you can stop spam.
And so, Brian, the whole point is to tell you about MailRoute. And the fact that MailRoute just gets rid of spam.
I'm sorry, what?
MailRoute. It just gets rid of spam. MailRoute.net.
That's okay. You can't make up a thing.
It's not made up. It's actually a sponsor. You've had them on your shows before. I'm surprised you don't recall. Yeah.
I don't remember that.
A memorable sponsor for you, I think.
MailRoute. MailRoute. So somehow, are you saying they have spam killing abilities? Are they like robots?
Yeah. They are like robots who kill all spam. And then, okay, look, you're saying like, oh, they kill all spam, but they probably like kill a lot of other stuff too. No, they are very smart robots. You throw them in a room, like at a mall, and you say, look, there's a bunch of spam in this mall. They will shoot and kill all the spam in the mall and leave all of the wholesome young shoppers and their parents absolutely unharmed.
Wait a minute. Are you saying that they can take out targeted strikes against spam with no casualties? No collateral damage?
Pretty much. Never. I have never had a false positive with them.
What? They've never accidentally killed a real message? Because that happens on my Gmail all the time.
Nope.
I still don't trust my Gmail to miss.
Then you should trust MailRoute.net.
Wow.
And in fact, if you're one of those people who use Postini, migrate from Postini for free plus 10% discount. Go try them out. MailRoute.net. Promo code FRAMERATE. Say, I want maximum no spam. I want your robots to kill all my spam. Start your 15-day free trial. Get 10% off the life of your account. No credit card required for the free trial. That's MailRoute.net. Click the sign-up button. Enter the promo code FRAMERATE, or pronounced FRAMERATE in some circles.
That circle being one person, Tom Merritt.
Pretty much me. All right, now on to the rest of Slipstream. We thank MailRoute for their support of FrameRate. Real quickly, BBC is going to join the Digital Entertainment Coalition. The DEC are the folks behind Ultraviolet. So when you buy DVDs of BBC programming, like Doctor Who, Downton Abbey, wait, not Downton Abbey, Doctor Who, Sherlock.
Did you start to list any show you knew of that took place?
Any show in English that is ever recorded?
Sure.
Whether it's got an accent or not. No, I always do that. I always think Downton Abbey's BBC, but it's not. But yeah, Sherlock or those kinds of things, you'll be able to get it in Ultraviolet. So the locker expands, keeping an eye on it, because they've got the right idea. It's the implementation that doesn't seem to quite be there yet, but maybe they'll fix that. Also, maybe. Spotify signed a TV deal with Samsung so that you can now stream your music right from your smart TV.
This was a very, very misleading ad, because we've been talking about Spotify having secret arrangements to have a TV-like interface for Spotify. And Spotify is providing the engine for the HBO Nordic as well, right?
Yeah, that was the rumor anyway.
So when it said Spotify signs TV deal, I was like, holy crap, they're doing TV programming.
Yeah,
like,
now
play music on your TV.
Just music. Also, Hulu and Viacom expanded their content partnership, so more Nickelodeon stuff. Coming to starting back on October 9th, Hulu Plus able to access 5 recent episodes of currently airing Nickelodeon action 21 days after the episodes are screened on TV. That's iCarly, Victorious, How to Rock, Super Ninjas, SpongeBob SquarePants, Kung Fu Panda, all that kind of stuff.
Right on.
Also, bilingual network Trace. The E is spelled with a 3, but I assume it's Trace. Is that going to be added to Hulu Latino and Hulu and BBC World? Worldwide announced they have entered another co-production agreement. They did The Thick of It, if you recall, last year. Now they're going to do a comedy called The Wrong Mans together.
The Wrong Mans?
They're Wrong Mans. Apparently they don't know how to conjugate proper verbs for plurals.
Okay. Pluralize.
Yeah. And Hate Bad Design would never forgive us if we didn't mention Netflix now streaming in Sweden. And more Scandinavian support coming all across Scandinavia. Apparently Denmark's going to get it soon.
Yeah, it's a good time to be in the area near the land of the midnight sun.
Yeah.
Because I almost did that thing where I mistook Sweden for Norway, but I would never do that because I've lived in Norway.
You they better not. They'll never let you back.
Mistake. That's right.
There was someone in the chat room earlier who was saying, who was in Sweden and said that selection's kind of thin right now. But that has been a typical complaint about Netflix when it launches in any country. Canada had the same experience. And then the idea is that they beef it up over time as they strike more deals. So
yeah.
We'll keep an eye on it. HBO coming to Scandinavia hasn't launched there yet, so Netflix actually beats them to the launch punch as far as that goes.
Right
on. Speaking of launch punch, let's launch punch right into Tube Talk. Oh, DirecTV, just when I cut the cord in the bedroom and get rid of that DVR, you come back and you come up with a brand new way to get me back into paying you more money. The Genie DVR set-top box. They're like, hey, don't want to set top box in your house, Tom Merritt? Not a problem. DirecTV Genie DVR takes in 5 content inputs, can record 5 shows at once on one box, and then stream them out to compatible TVs that use the RVU functionality. Or if you're like, I don't have one of those TVs, they'll give you a little tuner box that you can hook up to any TV, and then you could have whole home DVR with just one DVR instead of having to have a DVR in every freaking room.
I'll tell you what, man, it's DirecTV has for a long time, it seems to me, now I only occasionally get to use my parents' DirecTV, but it seems like for a long time they've really gotten it right as far as user interface. It seems like a lot of the stuff that I pine for from my days with my TiVo still exists alive and well on the DirecTV. And this is another, you know, giving people what you want. What a nutty idea.
And a terabyte of storage. Not bad.
Yeah.
Slingbox, as expected, did launch new models, the 350 and the 500. They have fancy new styles. They don't look like any of the other Slingboxes that have been out before. But if you don't care so much for the design, the Slingbox 350 is the cheaper one. It has 1080p HD video streaming and integrated infrared emitters. And the 500 has both those features plus built-in Wi-Fi, USB storage, a remote, and HDMI/component video ports. So this is pretty sweet new sling boxes, and I'm looking for the prices here. I don't see them, but I think it's $299 for the 500. So I can't imagine that the 350 is, you know, more than 150 or so. I just bought the 500 for $299, so I know that one off the top of my head.
Right on.
Also, TiVo fans will be excited. If you've had a TiVo premiere and you're like, gosh, the apps that I have on here are fine, but I would like some more apps, please. It's been years. TiVo has opened up a developer channel that lets third parties create apps for the DVR. Now, they still have to be approved by TiVo before they can be added to the TiVo system. So it'll be a little while before these are developed and put out there, but at least it's there. The developers can start working on it.
Yeah, and it's good. It's like, you know, you could complain like, oh, welcome to, you know, 2 years ago, Google TV land. But look, man, when somebody does the right thing, you don't gripe at them for how long it took, or at least you shouldn't. Or if you do, then I'm going to wave a finger at you via the internet and say, why are you discouraging them?
Shake of the head.
If I may, let me do that right now.
Yeah.
Why are you discouraging them? There.
Turn that into a segment. Get on that chat room. TiVo Stream eliminates a lot of the problems with TiVo's Desktop Plus software. So if you want to stream your recorded TiVo or your live TiVo streams to your iPad or iPhone, and only your iPad or iPhone because it only works with iOS, you plug the TiVo Stream into your router and it streams to your iOS device. It's a little weird because it doesn't actually stream directly from your television. It has to start a recording because it's only streaming off the hard drive. So you're going to end up with a lot of partial recordings of things, especially if you change the channel a lot.
Huh. All right. That's interesting.
But yeah, it's a box you plug into your, you know, it's really not going to be widespread. It's kind of an Apple device because you have to be using iOS and you have to be using a TiVo. But if you are, it supports up to 3 simultaneous streams from a single DVR, integrates nicely with the existing TiVo app, and you can actually download your TiVo recordings to your phone or your iPad. So that's kind of
cool,
too. I like being able to take things with me. Film Film. Hey, we're getting old, Brian.
Nuh-uh.
Because I think we covered Rian Johnson and his downloadable commentary for the Brothers Bloom. No?
Yeah. Wait, no.
Wait, it was 2008. We couldn't have. We weren't born yet.
Wait
a show.
Wait a tick.
I must have covered it on Buzz Out Loud then.
Did we, because I could have sworn that we had, that this was talked about or mentioned, because when I went and saw Looper, the only reason that I didn't get super big trouble was the moment I saw Looper, I was so thrilled because I'm like, I'm going to go see it again with my wife, so it's not really cheating if I go see it her again. And I'm not just going to have to sit through it a second time. Not that I would. It's a great show. But the fact that I could sit there and get an in-theater experience listening to Ryan Johnson's commentary on this, I'm very, very excited about.
Yeah, that's exactly what's going on. Whether Brian traveled in time to find out that information or not, what we're talking about is that Ryan Johnson recorded commentary that you can sync up when you're in the movie theater. And Johnson says, please do not listen to this the first time you go. I want you to watch the movie without my commentary. Please turn your screen brightness down. Do not annoy other people. Wear headphones. Don't play it out of your phone speakers. Don't be an idiot. But if you can follow those simple rules, he'll provide commentary. So you get a director's commentary while you're in the theater watching Looper. I think that's brilliant.
Do you think that he, intentionally, was not funny or clever during the commentary so as to avoid people bursting out laughing at inappropriate times?
No, during the commentary, he's like, all right, I'm going to make a very good joke about this next scene. Please try not to laugh too loud.
It's very, cover your mouth. Cover your mouth.
Cover your mouth now, because you're going to laugh, because it's a pretty funny joke.
Good. Yeah, man, I'm so stoked about this, and we've talked about it before. I loved when they did essentially the same thing with Ronald D. Moore on the Battlestar Galactica podcast. I think this is great. I think we're going to see more of this kind of thing, especially if I would be curious to know the download numbers on what this actually gets.
Have you heard about The Bay?
I watched this entire preview, and I'm really surprised by how plausible, how believably and interesting this is.
Barry Levinson's new movie, recorded entirely on consumer gear, much of it iPhone and Android phones, but some other like consumer level cameras as well, from the perspectives of the different characters in the movie as this tragedy happens. The conceit is that this is all footage that the government captured and made classified, and it has now been leaked, and you can see what happened in this small Maryland town when sea lice, which sounds funny, but they're actually very terrifying, take over and eat people from the inside out.
They're real, this is something, a believable parasite, which if you want to freak yourself out, go find, the crack.com article about the horrific parasites and how they take over parts of all kinds of the animals' bodies. Like, the first time something pops out, I totally jumped watching this trailer. And now, are you over found footage movies? Because I am not. I don't see why it's so popular just because it's a genre that you kind of are familiar with the tropes with, and now all of a sudden everyone's over it.
Well, yeah, I think a lot of people are overreacting. It's sort of like, I used to listen to that band before they sold out and made albums. But what I am over is found footage being the only reason to like a movie. I mean, and that used to be the thing, right? It was Blair Witch Project era. I remember sitting at the Jamaican bar on South Lamar in Austin, Texas, and talking to somebody about Blair Witch Project the first time, when it first was being released and people were talking about it. And it was like, wow, what a great idea for a movie. You know, not many people have done that kind of movie before. And it sounds like they're really doing it right. After that, we got a lot of these things and we've seen a lot of attempts. And so now I look at it, and I'm like, okay, found footage, that's been done. The concept itself does not overwhelm me, but did you do a good job with it? And yeah, it looks like maybe they did.
Yeah, this one does look good. We'll see.
Or it's not a movie.
Or, yes, it's an actual documentary, of course.
Well, and according to this article, they actually asked Levinson to make a documentary about Maryland's, bay environment, sort of a preservationist documentary, and instead he made this horror movie about
it. He's just having to scare the crap out of everyone.
Or is it the documentary?
That's right. This is. He's got the real research cred.
Io9 has a posting about True Skin, a short film from Stevens Lotescu and production firm N10N, or Nyon, about a cyborg on the lam in futuristic Bangkok.
This was cool because it had a totally different kind of story, a different aesthetic. It was something I'd never seen before, which becomes an increasingly rare and precious event. It's like magicians are the biggest fans of going to magic shows just because they're still looking for that high of being totally fooled. I thought from a science fiction perspective, you know, it was so colorful and the less than flattering ways it represents cyborgs. I don't want to say it was necessarily more believable or something, but it certainly felt like an entire world that I wanted to go spend more time in.
Yeah, I liked the fact that they set up a believable premise. It looks like I'm there. Well, you know, however they shot it and whatever post-processing they did for the effects, it's not immediately obvious what parts were whole cloth and what weren't. And it tells a compelling narrative about what happens when a lot of people start to enhance that echoes the kind of subcultures popping up into main cultures like piercings and tattoos and other things that we've seen, except with the sci-fi bent. I thought it was pretty cool, too.
Yeah. No, I would love to see this turn into something. Because what was the name of the short that eventually was retooled and became District 9?
I don't recall, but I know what you're talking about, yeah.
I would love it if it had this kind of life where it came back in a full-featured film down the road.
And then finally, you pointed out IO9 has up the first trailer for Sci-Fi's Defiance. That's the show that'll be part... this is the show that's part game, takes place in San Francisco, but then part TV series that takes place in St. Louis, right?
Yeah, this is the main thing I took from looking at the trailer, because they don't really give much away, is, boy, the aesthetic really looks video gamey. It almost looks like, I mean, I don't even know how to describe it, but you could tell that they are working synergistically with the video game folks to be able to have similar assets and similar, design choices across both platforms. I'll be really interesting and surprised if they actually pull it off, because as we've talked about before, the MMO is a very difficult space to make something that's successful, and science fiction is a very difficult space to make something successful. And to have a project whose stated goal is to thread the stone needle of that very small Venn diagram of people who are going to be interested in both that seems tough. But best of luck. I hope it works out.
Yeah, I hope so too. I you know, as someone who lives in the San Francisco area and grew up near St. Louis, I want them to get that part right too. I want to see them both destroyed in believable yet unbelievable ways.
Talking about getting destroyed in believable ways, you know what it's time to check in on.
The winter movie draft.
Waiting. Oh, YouTube. Go somewhere. All right, YouTube isn't playing.
We don't have this one local, huh?
No, well, this was the, I believe, Hate Bad Design redid it or whatever, and no, I don't have... Oh, wait a minute. Well, I don't have it local, but here. Arrgh. YouTube sucks. Go.
Can we keep this intro exactly how it
goes? That is actually our planned intro from now on. It's an editorial commentary. Winter movie draft. Father Robert Ballester, very humble during the draft. Oh, I don't think I'm... running away with it right now.
I'm telling you, he's out of steam. He's got nothing left. What's he up to? 124 million. And what movies does he have left? He's got Silent Hill Revelation, Jack Reacher, Django Unchained, and The Guilt Trip. Those, all four of those together aren't going to make $200 million. So he's
done. I don't know. 124 million is a nice start, though, with four movies left, let's just say. It depends on what those four movies make. You're absolutely right. My first movie, Here Comes the Boom, made 11 million last week. Not incredibly impressive. Almost cut Sinister, Scott Johnson's movie, which made 18 million. But we both outpaced Seven Psychopaths, which only made 4.1 million.
And I'm astonished because Seven Psychopaths was partly trading on the popularity of those actors, right?
Yeah. I'm stunned. I didn't expect it to make buku bucks at the box office, but 4 million? It's like nobody went to see it.
Yeah.
That's just sad. This week, you've got Paranormal Activity 4. It's getting beat up on Rotten Tomatoes right now, but people love Paranormal Activity, so they're probably going to come out to the theater.
That thing is a money maker. In fact, I remember it being the buy of the whole season last year when Justin Robert Young got it, and I don't think I paid all that much for it. What did I end up paying for
22,
the thing?
22. You paid 22, so you paid a decent amount.
Well, I'll tell you what, it's certainly going to do more than half again better than what I paid for Looper, because I paid 14 for Looper, and it's barely cracking 52 now.
I've got Alex Cross, which is a mystery with Matthew Fox as the villain. comes out this weekend.
That actually looks pretty good. I was surprised. I went the whole trailer without realizing it was Matthew Fox. And when it said his name, I was like, what?
This is based on a movie, or I'm sorry, on a novel by James Patterson. So it might get some James Patterson fans. He's a best-selling author into the theaters. And it might be pretty good.
Hold on. I have some breaking news that's breaking my heart. Felix the Cat in the chat room says, who has Lincoln? Lincoln is only being released in about 30 screens. If that's true, then I am screwed because I bought it based on the buzz and hype and how excited people were about it, talking Oscar-worthy or whatever. But if they're going to do that trick where they only just barely get it in this year and major release later, then I am totally boned.
I haven't heard anything about that.
Yeah, we'll have to see. Oh, wait, Felix the Cat says 300, which don't know if that's any better.
That's more believable than 30. I can't imagine them putting Lincoln out to only 30 screens. I mean, there's 30 screens in Los Angeles alone. So
Sure.
Even if they just did L.A. and New York, that's going to be more than 30 screens.
The 300 would be all art house only. Oh, my God.
No. You're screwed.
Right. Yeah.
Well, I'm just waiting on The Hobbits.
It's gonna cut up and you all your monies. All right, man.
Let's talk about what we're watching.
What we're watching.
We already talked about watching the awesome dude jumping out of space, but
so good.
Lots of other things we were watching. I just want to get this out of the way. Was watching lots of baseball this week in lots of different ways. I am more and more impressed with MLB.com because when I'm out and about with my phone, I get good streaming over LTE of the quad view. So I'm not, even though I'm blacked out from watching the regular broadcast, I can see four pictures, which is just as good for just sort of keeping an eye on things. And I get the audio from the major broadcast. I can also then, when I'm home, AirPlay that from my iPad to my big screen so I can watch it in any room that I've got an Apple TV in, which is my bedroom. And then, as I mentioned, I actually didn't watch all of the game last night on DirecTV. I switched from DirecTV to over the air after the third inning to compare. And at first I was like, it's not dramatically different. There's some artifacting that's gone. But it does look a little better. After six innings of watching it over the air, I don't think I want to go back to DirecTV for watching baseball. And granted, I'll have to for the games that are on cable and not over the air. But the lack of artifacting really built up over time. As I was watching more and more innings, I realized I was actually concentrating on the game more. I was less distracted by little things that I barely even realized I was being distracted by until I watched this much smoother broadcast.
It's amazing to me that 12 years after I first made the switch to digital, like first the big switcheroo boondoggle was to tell everyone that digital equaled good quality. And then you get up to those high rare channels like the Science Channel or, you know, one of the lesser known Discovery Networks. And it's like, it just looks terrible and it sounds terrible, but it's digital. And now you see the same thing with high definition. I still have not heard any marketing, any advertisement, any focus whatsoever on the end user quality of experience. It's all they do is they shout numbers, 1080p, 720p or whatever, not realizing that that in no way corresponds to the quality of the presentation.
Yeah, and as Scott Wilkinson was pointing out, and I was talking to him about this before frame rate, 720p is what they broadcast in. So 720p just means you're getting what they broadcast, but when they compress the signal, you're not getting exactly what they broadcast in, and that's where you get that artifacting.
Yeah.
I also watched more of H+, two or three more of those episodes, caught up, and I think I've hit my rhythm where I'm naturally like, ooh, I haven't watched H+ in a while, let me turn it on, and then there's two or three more episodes, and I get a nice little chunk of story.
So there's enough to dive in. So maybe it's time. Yeah, I guess at this point you're still enjoying it enough that it's worth following the story.
Yeah, I do wish there was more still.
Yep.
I'm still hungry for more. And I think that's why I'm like, okay, well, I won't watch it again for a while because I want it to build up. But
I guess that's got to be the kind of thing that drives them nuts to hear that complaint because they are like, our whole point is to have an awful lot of this. So just hang in there.
But I think that also another one of their points was we want you to figure out how you prefer to watch it. And I've kind of figured that out now, which is cool.
Well, that's good.
We obviously both watched the season premiere of Walking Dead. We're going to talk about that in the spoiler zone. But anything else that you watched you want to talk about?
I peeked in. Apparently Fraggle Rock is on Netflix instant streaming right now. So I went
Fraggle Rock
to try to remember if it was as good as I watched the pilot again. And I think I'm going to try to get my kids into Fraggle Rock, which will be weird because they haven't heard of it. It'll be, I don't know if that's a good thing because they hadn't heard of the Muppets before that movie came out. But this would be a straight up artifact from 1982 that I'm putting in front of them. And it's weird because you could see the kind of crude green screen haloing that they had back in the day. Like, man, so many of our memories really filter out a lot of the artifacting that we saw in this opening ad, you know, artificially put into the Wreck-It Ralph ad. But like, that's all real. That's how everything looked. And I just have no memory of that problem at all.
Was that on HBO?
Yes.
Yeah.
That wasn't the first HBO original, was it?
I believe it certainly was the first HBO original kids show.
Huh.
And I remember making news that it was one of the first originals that they had. And they had to explain.
I remember that too, because my dad had just canceled HBO and then Fraggle Rock came out. And I was like, come on. Nope. Sorry, kid.
That's awesome. They, okay. Oh, and I watched about half of The Business of Being Born because I, you know, we're getting ready to have another kid. And so.
What is that? Is that a movie?
It's a document. I'm going to use the air quotes. It's a documentary. I thought it was a documentary, and I figured, like many documentaries, they would have a position on one side or the other. But about halfway through, apparently it was commissioned by Ricky Lake, which, by the way, if you've ever wanted to see a completely naked Ricky Lake having a baby in her bathtub, boy, do I have the movie for you. Just all in her.
It's a niche, but they're out there.
That one guy is going to be very thrilled with this movie. But everything else, like about halfway through, it became clear that their position is hospitals be where sick people are, healthy babies be born at home. And I started to look up, this is a great trick. Whenever you see something that you smell one thing or the other, just type in the name of it and then the word skeptic, and you usually get some interesting specific rebuttals of claims made in the show. And once I got there, there's like some substantial what a math happening versus I'm not saying first of all, yes, have babies at home, get a midwife, do all those things. But once I saw how unbalanced it was, I sort of lost interest in even watching the rest. Like, I don't mind seeing something advocate for a position that I'm not going to follow myself, but I do mind when you use facts that have been rebutted in public to do it. Does that make sense?
Yes. Also science.
Yes. That's, whoa, boom. That's, yes, that's the one.
All right, let's get into feedback. Starting now up it's time with the song.
For feedback with Brian and Tom on Frame Rate, oh yeah.
Timmy. Actually, just signed it, Tim. Writes, Frame Rate crew, how can you not see this? You are the folks that tell me what to watch. I don't see why it matters that they're... is YouTube TV Guide channel hole. I think that you are already doing this, but on a more grand scale than just YouTube. It's very nice of him to say. I don't think we're very comprehensive, though.
No, but there was a number of people who, you know, we were talking about that there's no equivalent of the TV Guide, and a shocking number of people said, hey, you guys are it, by the way.
Stop it, you guys. Now so, I have to crow and create, like, a more comprehensive TV Guide for frame rate.
Yes,
great.
Please,
more work.
Talking about more work, this was my favorite email from David. Okay, Tom, you've managed to really tick me off and ruin my whole day with your argument over time travel. First, let me point out your gigantic-sized logical flaw. Both these statements cannot possibly be true. One, it's physics when you're arguing about that your view on time travel is correct. And two, that we know about when Brian Brushwood said there is no time travel except forward. And then he gets to the point, he says, if we do not know of any time travel except forward, then we do not know the physics except forward. Yes, I've heard and read all the theoretical time travel, but every one of those are untested theories without any experimental data to back them up. The simple truth is that travel back in time is most probably impossible because it would violate causality and just about every law of physics. And here's my favorite line. And what really ticks me off is that your dumb rant meant that Brian Brushwood was right, and I really hate it when Brian Brushwood is the reasonable one and you're the crackpot. It upsets my entire worldview. He says he enjoys the show, but stop arguing about time travel. There's a lot of people riled up about our talk about time travel.
Yeah, I think we got a lot of people going, because it's a classic nerd fight, right?
Sure.
To talk about... I will say, though, that I disagree that those two are conflicting. It can be physics and we not have direct experience about it. That's what theoretical physics is all about.
That's fine.
Most of quantum physics and relativity and all of that is, in fact, things that we don't experience. We don't experience faster or near light speed travel but we're fairly certain that Einstein's equations are right, that mass is accreted near infinity as we near the speed of light. Doesn't mean he's wrong just because we haven't experienced it. And science!
That's actually what I wrote to him.
There's actually plenty that I can say to respond to that, but let's move forward because we're running out.
No, because I want to talk about quantum electrodynamics and the facts that Richard Feynman proved that, in fact, particles do go back in time to balance equations. Okay.
Okay. No. That's
it. You're right. We should move on. And science!
Title of the show. Let's see. Adam Nielsen says, I'm a regular listener, big fan of the show. During your story last week discussing the new nightly newscast from the Washington Post, Tom remarked that this is a way for cord cutters to experience a traditional style newscast. I've always considered myself a cord cutter who watches nightly news using a digital tuner and over-the-air HD broadcast. Now I'm worried that watching, quote, regular TV doesn't make me as cutting edge as I thought it was. Am I just a cord cutting poseur? Is it? You say poser?
It's just,
I guess.
Poser, yeah.
Right. I like poseur.
Poseur.
Is cord cutting more than not just paying cable or satellite service? Do cord cutters cease to watch traditional network TV altogether? I still watch the majority of shows on demand over the internet, but use the antenna when I just want to see what's on. I'd love to hear an official ruling from the two de facto cord cutting experts on whether real cord cutters use an antenna. I don't know about you, Tom, but I say, yeah, man, that's legit. If you're free over the air, is officially in the cord cutters camp.
Yeah, I think free over the air is in the cord cutters camp, but it does bring up an interesting question. If you're using a cord at all, are you really a cord cutter? I mean, there's a cord going from your antenna to the back of your TV. There's an Ethernet cable cord going into your Roku box from your internet connection. I mean, if you're not just doing wireless, are you, in fact, also wireless power, because there's a cord going into the outlet.
I think clearly the defining line of what makes for a cord cutter is that we're tired of the stupid, gigantic, unfair, one-size-fits-all waste of a fee that we paid in cable networks to give us so much content that we should be able to get in other superior ways. And as long as you're giving the finger to cable companies and cutting that cord, then we, my friends, salute you.
I believe that you are, Adam, a cord cutter. So I think we're so ruled. Thomas in Chicago finally says, I watch a few YouTube premium channels, and my gripe is that you can't just subscribe to a show. You have to subscribe to the entire channel. What I don't like about this is that I have to scroll a lot to find new episodes of the shows I like amongst all the shows that are on the channel. With a channel like The Nerdist, it sometimes takes a lot of scrolling to find the new episodes of Four Points. That is an interesting thing, is YouTube has, you know, created this channel thing as like, okay, this is your discovery element. You subscribe to the channel, so get people to subscribe to your channel, and then it will show up on their little left side nav, and everybody's happy. But the channel isn't the show, and just like you don't like necessarily every show on AMC, but you like several shows, you don't want to be forced to have to scroll through all of them to find the shows you like.
Well, and the problem also is that YouTube has trained people to expect a certain talent on a channel at all time. You know, even if every single video, vlog is from a different location and with a different subject, it's always the same guy giving his story. But when you have a channel, all of a sudden you take like 6-8 different people with 6 or 8 different shows, 6 or 8 different presentational styles, and you throw them all together. And do you think there's something about it that just smells too cable-y for people, and that might be something that would prevent somebody from subscribing to some of them?
Yeah, because somebody pointed out in the chat room here, Beatmaster pointed out, the channels can make smart playlists. That's what Geek & Sundry does. But it still isn't the same as saying, like, I just want to subscribe to Tabletop. That's all I want to watch. Well,
and to be honest, that's what I would have done with Sword and Laser, but I still haven't clicked subscribe on Geek & Sundry just because the only thing I'd want to see is Sword and Laser.
Well, you should watch Tabletop, actually. It's a really good show.
I hear great things. I hear great things about Tabletop.
And The Guild. And written by kids. Well, I mean, that's amazing.
Okay. Well, see, now you're doing it. Now you're excuse for why everyone should subscribe to everything.
But they're good shows. I mean, and that's the thing, right? Every channel thinks like, but all our shows are good, but there's no accounting for taste. People have different tastes, and whenever you fight the taste of the consumer, you lose.
Correct. Give them free choice, people.
And we know what you want. You want us to end the show so we can get to the spoiler zone and talk about The Walking Dead, because either you want to stop watching this show because you don't want to be spoiled, or you want to hear what we have to say about it. Either way, we have feedback coming in the spoiler zone. So if you do want to be spoiled about Walking Dead, stick around. Otherwise, thanks everybody for watching. You can find us on the web at framerate.twit.tv. Actually, it's twit.tv/fr. You can email us framerate@twit.tv, though, and let us know what you think about time travel or anything else or cord cutting. We want to hear from you. Watch us live on Mondays at 6 p.m. Eastern, 3 p.m. Pacific. We'll see you next time.
Stand by.
Do it.
Stand by. Fingers over the trigger and...
Silent breed is people!
Silent green is people?
A spoiler? Really? Right
here? Really? Right then.
It's just tacky. Just bad. Just bad form.
All right. Clear? Everybody clear? Who doesn't want to be spoiled by The Walking Dead? Y'all gone from the chat room?
Wow, the studio is really empty now.
On your headphones? Are they really? Did you guys head down?
I love that we have
although we do have Tony
came
watching
forward.
From
came closer, actually.
From above.
Like, I didn't want to hear your crappy show, but now you're talking about Walking Dead. I'm in. That looks spooky up there.
Yeah.
What'd you think? It's all right, huh?
Well, okay, first of all, you know that during the time, I don't think I... hold on. As I've mentioned, I was not a fan of the second season of Walking Dead, but I've given them a one-time pass that I'm just treating like you know, I'm going to reset all my expectations. Whatever the show is going to be from here on, they're going to start showing me in this season 3. And I got to tell you, man, I really dug it. I dug the way they clearly came back with a changed group of people that have been hardened over the winter, however good or bad it was. It gives a reason for the kid to get older. What's his name again?
Carl.
Carl, right. Carl's older and being trusted with bigger responsibilities.
Yeah, he's allowed to carry his gun all the time now.
Yeah, there's no there's less pride. Although I was kind of disappointed that they had the scene where he took the dog food away and threw it in. I wouldn't have expected Rick, the survival leader, to still be proud about eating dog food.
That kind of ran counter to the whole theme they were pointing out. Is like, these folks have been together so long, they don't even need to talk. They're efficient. They go and they find stuff. I expected him to kind of look at it, kind of shake his head, and just start dividing it up. Not,
yes.
No, we won't eat dog food. It's like, yeah, that struck a weird note with me as well.
Yeah, that really, I would say that's my only major complaint. Even then, that's a small
major complaint. That's pretty minor.
I know. And then I liked that you're seeing a very methodical, slow exploration of the prison. This is exactly how I would be. Everything is believable. Nothing is shocking. Nothing's throwing me out. I'm glad Andrea is off of the stupid other people's camp. I'm sad that...
Well, she's not yet. She's with Michonne.
Well, it's clear that that's where they're headed off to,
right?
Yeah,
in the previews for next week, that's obviously where they're headed.
And it's amazing to me, as you've heard me complain before, like, Andrea was my favorite character in the comic book, and to see her turned into my least favorite person in the TV show is really a weird headspace for me to be in. But I tell you, man, it's across the board. I think they're nailing it. I think they're doing exactly what they have to do.
Lots of gore.
Yes.
And I think that was needed. Because I think one of the problems with last season wasn't that the plot dragged per se,
right,
but it was a lot of talking heads. And as anybody who's watched Framerate knows, that's boring. So, I mean, but seriously, we watch Walking Dead because we want to see zombies try to eat people and the zombies get poked through the head with a weapon of some sort. And that just wasn't happening. And if that's what you missed, boy, you got to feast on this episode.
Yeah, I'll tell you what else. It was interesting to see them take elements and recast them with other characters. For example, in the comic book, it's Dale who gets his foot cut off in order to try to save him. But then they redid it with Herschel instead. And there was another theme. I think one of the couplings, obviously with Daryl and I always forget the short gray-haired chick. Anyway, some of the romantic budding interests that are happening, a lot of the couplings and stuff were originally written for other characters in the comic, but it's interesting to see them bringing back those comic book themes, hopefully maybe getting the show less on track. I didn't mind that they diverged from the comic. What I minded is that they appeared to diverge just for the sake of divergence.
Yeah, exactly. The divergences between this episode and what happens at the prison in the comic book seemed motivated. They seemed valuable, and they seemed to be taking things in interesting ways, like Herschel's daughter and her interaction with Carl. I have no idea what's going on with that. They're obviously hinting towards something. And I'm like, oh, what's that going to... That's weird. Okay, let's see what goes on there.
I mean, that was the other recasting. Thanks for reminding me, because Sophia was still around, and you started to see him and Sophia really bond with each other. But of course, they killed off Sophia, so it was important that they bring that dynamic, I assume.
Same dynamic? Because she's older than Sophia was in the book.
Yeah, she is. But you know,
so
also
it's a little weirder.
They've oldened the kid up as well. Yeah, so Carl can have, you know, it wasn't explicitly romantic when they were kids, but you're looking at 2 10-year-olds. But now that Carl's looking closer to a 14,
you're rooting for him, aren't you?
Yeah. Yeah.
Go Carl.
I wanted to get that farmer's daughter action. Go for it, Carl.
And the way they, as you said, you made this point already, but I just want to second it, is the way they methodically went into the prison fit with the way they went into the prison in the book. It wasn't a mimic of it.
No.
Frame for frame by any stretch, but it was the same sense of caution combined with experience from being on the road at that point, the attraction of the prison as a safe place that they could defend, the same kind of fence layout that allows them to easily see, like, okay, I see how they could, like, dig in here and make it work, but the same challenge of that dark interior prison filled with zombies, and of course the big reveal at the end when they find the prisoners.
Yeah, and so and that was a cool moment as well. Now tell me, there's something that doesn't bother me yet, but I think it might start at some point. Is it possible for any of them to miss a headshot from 30 to 40 yards away as they casually run through a field of zombies, just sort of like,
what's her name almost hit Rick twice.
Okay, but that's the only time they're allowed to miss, is if it's a plot point. In fact, I'd be interested to see if there's ever a time that it's not a big deal that they miss. Because the number of times they just casually half-looking and shoot headshots are hard. They're doubly hard when you're running and under pressure and moving all around. And I wouldn't mind seeing, it's like, you don't have to make a big deal about it. Just show them this.
I feel like I've seen them miss while running in a pressure situation to add to the drama before. I feel like I've seen that.
I guess that's the problem, is you're only allowed to miss if it's to heighten drama.
Well, but here's the thing, Brian. It's like showing someone going to the bathroom. Like, do you really want to watch that? or should you spend that time on something that advances the story? Like, if it's just like, if we spend, you know, a few minutes with people just like, ooh, I missed that one. Ooh, I missed that one. It's you know, it's kind of boring.
No, it is in no way like showing.
All right, it's not like watching them actually in the bathroom, but I'm saying, like, you watch somebody, like, open the door, go in the bathroom, and close it, and you're looking at a closed door, like, well, this really happens. I'm glad they're showing this, because people actually do spend time, you know, in the bathroom. Like,
no, it's verisimilitude, if I'm saying the word correctly. It's
no,
that,
you're not.
It's that little bit of believability. How is it? Verisimilitude?
I think it's, I think that's close.
Verisimilitude.
Yeah.
It's verisimilitude.
Yeah.
Is what it is. But it's that wabi-sabi. It's those little chinks and defects that that make it to where you believe this whole thing as a whole enterprise. And the fact
I guess you're right. Very, like, lightly sprinkled here and there, like, oh, I missed that one. You know, that could be kind of cool.
Yeah.
Don't want to spend too much time on it, though, because you're like, why are they always missing? They suck.
No, now on to my last point. They need to show nothing but characters going to the bathroom.
And not with the door closed either, you sicko. yeah, I know. I thought this was infinitely better than most of the episodes from last season. I am very interested in how they're going to play the governor and that part where Andrea and Michonne are headed. I love that Michonne is there and that we're going to get to know her in a different way. I like these departures so far. So I'm generally positive about this season.
Hey, you know what's kind of weird? To someone like me who couldn't possibly have looked at a spoiler and is about to drop one about what's going to happen in an upcoming episode.
We get to see Michonne go to the bathroom?
Yes. Did you notice the friend of the NSFW, NSFW show, Michael Rooker, is still tweeting? Like, he seems really excited about the season.
I'm glad you brought that up, because I was watching the baseball game while Walking Dead was on at 6 o'clock, right? Because we get the East Coast feed, so I can watch it at 6 o'clock Pacific. But I was like, well, I'll just watch it after the game. So I'm watching the game, and I see these tweets from Michael Rooker, like, yeah, you know, F yeah. And I'm like, oh, I wonder, are we going to get to see Merle in this? Not a peep.
Yeah, not a peep. But, you know, it just seems weird. Like, you know, if his character truly was dead, maybe, I'm just saying, Michael Rooker seems awfully interested in this season.
His hand could come back.
Sure. Maybe that's what it is. Maybe
the zombie
that's
hand that attacks the prison. That's what I think.
Amazing. Look, I'm very excited. I'm excited to see them return to the spirit of the comic book. I'm excited to see the pacing. I'm excited to see them hardened. And I think it's good. Hardened and oldened they have become.
You know what? Beatmaster says, can we get two showrunners from Walking Dead at the end that confront Tom and Brian's Saturday Night Live style? We did have Robert Kirkman on the show.
And that's true.
We quailed before him like little boys.
That's right. We praised him, singing his praises not so.
You've done a great job, Mr. Kirkman. We love your work.
We are cowards.
So fair point, Beatmaster. Fair point. Yeah, that's it. Anything else to add before we wrap up the spoiler zone?
No, man. I think we're good. I'm excited about it.
So that's it for the spoilers. What?
Wait. We did have that one letter. Do you want to just quick?
No, I'm glad. I almost forgot about that. You're right.
Yeah, spoiler letter. So this is back to the time travel issue. Daryl says, long time, first time. After listening to Tom's thoughts about time travel, which you were very clear on, I have a question for him regarding the Dark Tower. I know that both he and Brian are a fan of the series. Tom, what did you think about the time travel in the Dark Tower? Wait, TDK.
And the Dark Knight.
In the Dark Knight. In the Dark Tower.
What do you think about time travel with TDK cassettes?
For me, one of the more fascinating storylines, this is it, this is your last chance to avoid spoiler, people, was how the two of the major characters, spoiler, Roland and Jake, start to go insane because they were remembering two different versions of an event, spoiler, Roland letting Jake die by versus saving him. I thought that this was there are other worlds than these. I thought this was an interesting take on the rules of time travel and made for some gripping scenes. When you read the book, did this bother you? And was it something that you had to set aside like you did for Looper? Just curious.
Yeah. Daryl, that was exactly my point, is that these things don't ruin anything for me. They just bug me as time travel, but I set them aside. They're like wizards and glass.
Well, I guess it helps. It helps that there's enough magic in that world that you could just throw it away. You know, if you could swallow the dragons and the magic in Game of Thrones, then, you know,
I don't consider it hard sci-fi. If something was billing itself as hard sci-fi and was like, we're going to stick to the rules of science, then it would really bother me. But otherwise, it doesn't bother me. It just nags at me a little bit, but I get over it really fast. So, no.
All right. Fair enough.
Yeah. All right. Now we are done. So thank you for joining us in the spoiler zone. We will spoil you no more. Go now.
And there are other shows than these.
There are other shows than these. Exactly.
All right.
Go then. There are other shows than these.
It was a great episode. That was fun. Really, really good.
Yeah, we had good stuff.